So this week we're considering a very particular question, Al. And that question is this. Can being in a musical group with your romantic partner ever be destined for anything other than professional and personal disaster? Or in other words, was being in Stereolab actually at all enjoyable? I have some quotes to kind of add some context to this question for you all. So Tim Gane had this to say about making the album Transient Random Noise Bursts. Making that record was pure hell. In the end, I hated it, and I've pretty much hated it ever since. About Emperor Tomato Ketchup, he said, it was a difficult time. A lot of bad feeling, a lot of relentless touring. Okay. And Laetitia Sadier had this to say. She said, being on tour with Stereolab was crushing and exhausting. It was a way of working that was industrial and mass-produced that drove me crazy. We weren't laughing much. She then went on to say, I found it very difficult. To be in a collab project with my boyfriend was traumatizing. Sometimes I felt I was an object rather than an active participant. It was not a nice feeling. We were young and insecure. It was fantastic, but not always fun. Mm. What do those quotes suggest to you, Ollie, about the band dynamics of Stereolab?
So I think, first of all, with any group that are going to be active for the best part of two decades, obviously there's going to be periods of time where you're not gelling as well, where you're not getting on. That isn't particularly controversial. But I think what Sadier is talking about goes beyond simple arguments between bandmates, between friends. The idea of feeling objectified whilst in the group, that's something that's a lot more serious. And I think it needs to be remembered that she was the only woman in Stereolab for long stretches. And naturally, you know, you're a bit more exposed as a singer than hiding behind a guitar, as she kind of said about Tim. I think the band dynamics are also tied to some other important events that happened in the group. And I think it's another reason why Mary Hansen's tragic death in 2002, who was the lady that we were talking about earlier, was so tragic, because it isolated Sadier even further within the group, because she'd lost not only one of her best friends, but also the only other woman in the band is no longer there. It also links to the way that the band was spoken about, particularly in France. There's a lot of misogynistic, sexist reviews that I've read from the 90s where, you know, they're not... French journalists weren't even talking about Stereolab's music. They were just, you know, saying, quote, you know, non-sexy Sadier, like, can't sing, etc. So I think there's a lot of things that tie into why I can definitely understand why being in Stereolab probably was not joyous for Sadier a lot of the time.
Yeah, I mean, I think we should probably call it what it is, which is that it was, you know, the dynamics were sexist. And I mean, I don't want to speak about, you know, Gane being a control freak or anything like that, because ultimately his meticulousness represents the bits of Stereolab I like most, like that arrangement, the fussiness, all those layers. That's why I love Stereolab. But if you want to talk about why Stereolab were able to go on for as long as they did before they kind of broke up unofficially, it's because of Sadier's capacity for compromise, really. And to use my kind of degree and maybe get a bit too critical theory about this all, you can make quite a nice link between the way that Sadier was positioned in the band with how, you know, the worker is positioned in capitalism. Because if you think about Gane, literally controlled everything. You know, he controlled the means of production. He wrote all the songs. He wrote all the melodies. He did all the recording. So when he gave the songs to Laetitia Sadier, she couldn't sing her own melodies. She couldn't sing her own tunes. Literally all she had control of was the lyrics. In a similar way, you know, when we're kind of trying to protest against, you know, governments or capitalism, whatever you want to say, the only thing you really have is your voice. Maybe you have to sing their tune or sing to their tune, but you can choose your words. Which is why I think it's so important that Laetitia Sadier chose the words she did and was so strident about, you know, Marxism or whatever with her lyrics. It's almost like, you know, we are Laetitia Sadier's in a world full of Tim Gaines, or that's sometimes how it feels, at least.
I feel like as a fervent, you know, anti-capitalist, I think she'd actually quite like that analogy, mate.
She would. I mean, I'll have to pass it on to her at some point. But yeah, like, full credit has to go to her for, like, her part in the group. And obviously, you know, it's very easy to talk about the singular male genius behind a music group like Tim Gane. But she contributed a lot to their sound, I think, ultimately.
I think you're right, because you're speaking how, you know, Gane's meticulousness is one of the things that, you know, you find most attractive about the band. But I think for me, when I think of Stereolab, the first thing I think of is her voice. And, you know, there's definitely something to be said to that was her tiny little thing, and she made it one of the most important aspects of the entire group.
Absolutely, couldn't have put it better myself. To end this little segment of alternate cuts, I have a quote for you, Ollie, that might illustrate what we were talking about. So in 2019, when Stereolab reformed to do some touring, And they were in an interview with a Guardian journalist, and the journalist asks, you know, why are you touring again now? And Tim kind of mumbles back to the journalist saying, oh, we're promoting the reissuing of our back catalogue. And Laetitia Sadier, very, you know, forthright, very clearly interrupts and says, no, it's for the money. Just like completely like that, it's for the money. And it kind of reminds me of a bit of what Jack White said about the White Stripes. If you ever see us touring again, it's for one reason and one reason only, and that's the money. So in answer to that original question of can being in a band with your partner be destined for anything other than, you know, complete acrimonious failure?
Maybe not.
The answer is probably not, yeah.